welcome back. This is Rakesh Naik, and today we are going to start a new topic, this theory of computation or FLAC, formal language and automata theory. In BTech level, when people start learning about this subject, people think that this is a very difficult subject. But let me tell you, this is not that difficult as you are thinking. In this video, I am going to create a mindset for you where you will feel this is not at all a difficult subject, and you will feel already we know the subject. So before we start, a small information I'd like to share. In this channel, we produce every video in two different languages, Hindi as well as in English. If you want to watch this video in Hindi, kindly follow the link given in the description. And if you have not yet subscribed, please subscribe and press the bell icon so that you will get regular updates from this channel. So let us start. This topic, theory of computation, you open any book, you will find this first line. It is a mathematical model for computation. When we say theory of computation, it means what? Some kind of computation is there. It means we'll use an electronic device that will compute for us. Let us talk about a computer. So when you are talking about a computer, you are not creating a computer, rather you are creating a mathematical model how the computer is going to compute for you. As a definition, people generally say it is an abstract machine that can be in exact one of the finite number of states at any given time. What is the meaning of that? So here you see there are two basic words are there, abstract and machine. So are we going to design any machine? No, we are not a mechanical engineer. We are not designing any machine here. As we will be learning about inputs, about outputs, about states, whatever generally we have in a machine. So that's why we can say it is a machine. So is it a machine? But no, there is no machine available physically to show you. So what kind of machine it is? It is an abstract machine. What is the meaning of abstract machine? It will not be physically available. It will be abstract. For example, let us say whatever program you are writing, it is done in the CPU, right? An abstraction of it is shown in the monitor, isn't it? So is it that whatever you see in the monitor, is it the output? No, the output is there in the CPU. An abstraction of it, you see it in the monitor, right? So it means we are going to design some kind of a system. It's supposed to be an abstract system. It will not practically be available. We are going to design mathematically. Few more words are available here. A finite number of states. An algorithm or a program is nothing but change in the state of the variable. Now the variable contain data 1. After some time it will take data 2 or 3 or 4. The variable is changing the states. And ultimately, I am getting a particular output, right? So it means at a particular time, a particular variable it holds. So that is what a finite state machine is. So except the nature, I don't feel any other system is infinite. All other systems are finite. It means we'll be having finite number of inputs, we'll be having finite number of output, and we'll be having finite number of states. This course supposed to be very fundamental and prerequisite for artificial intelligence. And for this subject, you must know mathematical foundation of computer science. I hope already you have learned about mathematical foundation of computer science, MSCS or discrete maths. Right? So already you are having the background and you are ready to learn this particular subject. I'll give you one more example what the subject is about. Suppose you want a favorable decision from your principal and you want to go to meet your principal. You generally go and directly approach, or you ask somebody, what is the state of the principal right now? What do you mean? What is it mental state? Whether he will be able to understand you properly, whether it is the right time for you to present your particular problem to get a favorable solution or not. So this is what a state is. So on a particular state, when you give a particular input, you get a particular output, and the state of that particular thing changes to another state. This is what we are going to learn. So it means we'll be having some kind of an abstract system. We are going to give some kind of input to it, and it will change its state and we'll finally get some kind of output. So in order to understand finite automata, output supposed to be known. If you don't know output, you cannot decide about your inputs. So that's why for any kind of system, for any kind of proofs, you know the outputs basically. And based on the outputs, you decide your input. And based on the input, you decide how the system is changing its state and finally gets the output. Now, when the word automation comes, is it something like automatic washing machine kind of thing? To some extent, yes. Automation doesn't mean that it will do your work automatically. But the main thing is, we'll take the work and take input accordingly, and finally it will get you a desired output. Getting a desired output is called automation. It is not that doing it by itself. So whenever you put your clothes into your washing machine, what happens? It takes the weight. Then depending on that, it decides when to inlet the water. It decides how much detergent need to be kept and then how much to spin. So after all these things, it get rise of your clothes and give you the clothes. So unless and until you plan for this much of weight of cloth, this much input is required, this much spinning supposed to be done, and after that the state of the machine will go from this state to this state, your automation of your automatic washing machine cannot be performed. I hope you understood by this. So automation doesn't mean that everything need to be done automatically. So a finite system is a mathematical model of a system that has certain input. So without input, you cannot do. Sometimes input is also not required and the system changes its states. It is also possible. Like for example, you kept milk at night. In the morning, the state changes to curd. Isn't it? So like that, sometime you don't give any kind of input as such, but still it make changes. And sometime you give input. You must get an output. Unless and until you get an output, what is the use of this automation? So a output is a must. There may be a input to the system or not, but the output is a must. Next thing is, it is defined by a list of states. From one state, it will transfer to other state, and from that state, it will transfer to other state. So like that, after certain number of change, you will get a final output, which is desired. And the state can change from one state to another state in response to some external input. And the change from one state to another state is called transition. Some characteristics are there. We are giving some kind of input. So at a discrete instance of time, let us say T1, T2, T3 instance of time we are saying, and we are giving I1, I2, IN as our inputs. And each input is taken finite number of time and for a finite value from a set of input alphabet. Then what is input alphabet? Let us say you are talking about English language and we are having 26 alphabets A to Z. Does the combination of 26 alphabets every time give me a meaningful word or meaningful sentence? Answer is no. So input alphabets are those discrete inputs that I can give in combinations. The next thing is the output. So there can be more than one output for a particular system. Is it possible? Yes, it is possible. For example, let us think about a digital camera. You are clicking up pictures and it is saved in the memory card. Right? If the memory card is full, is it possible to save any more pictures into it? No. Even though you click 1000 more times, because the memory is full, you cannot save it. Either you have to delete any more picture which is earlier existing and save it, or you need to discard the current picture that you have clicked. every time you are not saving. One instance, when the memory card is not full, directly it is getting saved. That is one kind of final state you are getting. And in the other case, if the memory card is full, you are discarding the picture. So there is one more final state you are getting. So every time in a particular automation, it is not possible that you will be having only one output. There can be several final state when you can say you got the output. And there are instances of time of a finite automata, and that is written in the form of states. So as I have given you earlier the example of states, it is enough I think. But you can think about a washing machine or a digital camera and think about what are the different states you are having. There can be many states, but there will be definitely a initial state from where you will start working, and there will be definitely at least one final state where you are ending. And sometimes the initial states become the final states also. Next, the relationship between the states. As we have already discussed, that state is nothing but instance of time. How that from one state I'll get the other state. So there must be some kind of transition or some kind of relation based on which the state will change. That is also required in order to find a finite automata. The next thing is the output relationship. Sometime only the state will determine the output, or it may happen that along with the state, what input you are given, it will determine the output. This is a very important subject from any exam point of view. And if you don't know about this subject, you are going to miss a few questions. And let me tell you, this is one of the easiest subject if you are having little bit knowledge about discrete maths. Because it is prerequisite for it. Okay, so in this topic, we'll be discussing about finite automata that will work on a regular set. This is most fundamental thing we discuss. After that, we'll discuss about context-free language that will be adopted by pushdown automata. And again, we'll enhance it for Turing machine and undecidable. So in this subject, these are the topics that we are going to discuss. So initially, we'll discuss about finite automata, enhance it to context-free language, then we'll enhance it to Turing machine, then we'll go to undecidable problem. I hope I have given you enough motivation for this particular subject. In our next video, we are going to start seriously about the prerequisite and other relevant thing regarding this topic. So see you then. Take care. Bye.